place where pettiness has no home, and love, as we all know it should, conquers all. I have been taught heavenly lessons here.
Assalamu alaikum.
Zaytuna College is producing students like Fatima Knight. Who...
Briefly, before we begin, I just want to make a quick announcement. We are blessed to have truly giants of the community on stage, and I am speechless and honored to be standing here among them. A brief announcement that Imam Zaid Shakir and Sheikh Muhammad Al-Yaqoubi, as well as Sheikh Faisal Abdul Razak, will be at a benefit dinner Monday in Willowbrook, Illinois, at Ashton Place, a benefit for the Syrian crisis. So I just want to make that brief announcement. If you can come, if you can attend and support this worthy cause, please do. I also encourage everyone, we just came off of an amazing session about the ISNA campaign about women-friendly masajid. I urge every single one of you to sign that statement, put your commitment in black and white online. If you can sign it in person, please do. And then as our speakers and scholars said, take it to your masjid and turn the words and rhetoric into action. I encourage every single one of you to do that. I did it. As soon as they said the statement was out, I did it. Alhamdulillah, all praise and thanks is due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so, I just wanted to make that brief announcement. We will go ahead and begin our session, a very important session. We'll begin it. A'udhu billahi min ash-shaytan ar-rajim. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Wassalatu wassalamu ala rasulillahi al-kareem. Wa ala alihi wa ashabihi ajma'in. Ameen. Ya rabbil alameen. A'udhu billahi min ash-shaytan ar-rajim. أَمْ حَسِبْتُمْ أَنْ تَدْخُلُوا الْجَنَّةَ وَلَمَّا يَأْتِكُمْ مَثَلُ الَّذِينَ خَلَوْا مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ مَسَّتْهُمُ الْبَأْسَاءُ وَالضَّرَّاءُ وَزُلْزِلُوا حَتَّى يَقُولَ الرَّسُولُ وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا مَعَهُ مَتَى نَصْرُ اللَّهِ أَلَا إِنَّ نَصْرَ اللَّهِ قَرِيبٌ صَدَقَ اللَّهُ الْعَظِيمُ. Do you think that you will enter paradise while such trials have not yet come to you or come to as those that have passed before you? Those people were touched with poverty and hardship and were shaken until even their messenger and those who believed with him said, where is the help of Allah? Unquestionably, indeed, no doubt about it, the help of Allah is near. Of all the beautiful verses of the Quran, this verse, I must admit, my brothers and my sisters, scares me to death. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has told us that we will be tested, that the path to Jannah will not be easy, that each one of us will be tested with adversity, with difficulty, with pain, and happiness, and plenty, and blessing, and the way we respond will determine, and then through Allah's grace and mercy, our ultimate end. And since this is a theme about stories, this session is particularly special to me because my wife and I lost our daughter to cancer 6 years ago. And so to hear the giants of our community tell us and share with us what the spiritual response should be to adversity is something that I will, inshallah, try to take into my own heart tonight with you all. So without further ado, let me introduce our first speaker, Sister Hadia Mubarak. She gave me her bio beforehand, and it was too long to share with you tonight. I think every single one of the speakers here tonight is, as we say in Arabic, غَنِيٌ عَنِ الْتَقْدِيمِ, you know. They don't need to be introduced. We all know them very well. Sister Mubarak is adjunct professor of religious studies at the University of North Carolina at Charlotte and Davidson College. Please join me in welcoming Sister Hadia Mubarak.
الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على سيد المرسلين وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. I'm honored to be here among my teachers and mentors and role models all of whom have had an immense influence on my spiritual and intellectual growth and to whom I feel indebted for their service on behalf of our community. I'm especially honored to be here with my mother, if she's here in the room, Fatima Mubarak, who instilled within me at a young age a love for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and who taught me to be ever conscious of my ultimate meeting with him. And I'm honored to be here with all of you. You have all traveled from distant areas, sacrificing time and money to be here, which is an indication of your commitment to a higher level of spiritual understanding and your desire to seek nearness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And I pray that you reap the fruits of your efforts. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala promises in Surah An-Najm, chapter 53, وَأَن لَيْسَ لِلْإِنسَانِ إِلَّا مَا سَعَى وَأَنَّ سَعْيَهُ سَوْفَ يُرَى. And that man shall only reap that which he strives for, and that for which he strives shall surely be realized. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala continues in Surah An-Najm, ثُمَّ يُجْزَاهُ الْجَزَاءَ الْأَوْفَى. And then he will be rewarded a complete reward. Not only does God promise to reward those who strive for good, who strive to seek his pleasure, but he promises to give them the utmost reward, the most that one could possibly attain. And after reminding us that we ultimately reap what we seek and that we will be recompensed accordingly, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us, وَأَنَّ إِلَىٰ رَبِّكَ الْمُنْتَهَىٰ. And to God belongs the end of all things. Brothers and sisters, it is during this time of great tribulation and crisis throughout the world today that we need to seek spiritual strength by reviving our relationship with God, the creator of the heavens and earth and everything in between. I believe that one of the greatest calamities that face us today is a spiritual one. For many young people, the painful situations they witness across the world, the atrocities that they see committed in the name of their faith, and on top of that, the demands imposed upon them to answer very complex theological and jurisprudential questions that jurists and legal scholars have spent centuries debating have led many to become disenchanted with religion, feeling jaded, and even questioning their belief in God. In many ways, we are partially to blame for this state of affairs. For in our pedagogy of Islam and our teaching, we have failed to present Islam as the God-centered faith that it is. And we have made Islam about everything but God. In our mosques and institutions, arguments abound about where women should pray, about whether or not our children should celebrate birthdays, and whether or not we should vote for the Muslim candidate who supported gay rights. We have reduced Islam to arguments and contentions among us while neglecting that the essence of our religion is about preparing the soul for its ultimate meeting with God. In Surah Al-Inshiqaq, chapter 84, verse 6, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يَا أَيُّهَا الْإِنسَانُ إِنَّكَ كَادِحٌ إِلَىٰ رَبِّكَ كَدْحًا فَمُلَاقِيهِ. That, O man, you are ever toiling, laboring towards your Lord, an arduous toil, a difficult one, but you shall meet him. فَمُلَاقِيهِ. You will be meeting him. And throughout the Quran, we find this as a recurring theme over and over, Allah reminding us of our ultimate meeting with him. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in Surah Al-Mu'minun, chapter 23, أَفَحَسِبْتُمْ أَنَّمَا خَلَقْنَاكُمْ عَبَثًا وَأَنَّكُمْ إِلَيْنَا لَا تُرْجَعُونَ. Did you really think that we created you in vain and that you would not return to us? And again here, the us is brought forward. وَأَنَّكُمْ إِلَيْنَا لَا تُرْجَعُونَ. In this verse, there's a direct correlation between the significance of our existence and our return to God. In other words, the proof that life is not futile, that we were not created in vain, is our return to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And it is only our awareness of this ultimate return that gives our lives on earth any meaning or purpose. For the journey of a traveler who is unaware of his or her destination is pointless, irrelevant, and meaningless. The purpose of life can only be comprehended within a framework that establishes the afterlife as its benchmark. For only when we understand that we will return can we ever understand why we are alive. The concept of a rebirth or return to God implies consequence. It implies human accountability. And the essence of our deen is moral accountability. It is a recognition that by virtue of being alive, we have a duty and a moral obligation to God, to humanity, and to ourselves. It is a recognition that we cannot justify the time we spend on this earth unless we contribute to it in a meaningful way, unless we attempt to create change, unless we leave behind something that makes this world better than we found it, unless we attempt to improve the lives of those around us and alleviate grievances. It is this sense of social and moral conscience that has distinguished Islam throughout its history. And it is this legacy that we need to revive in our world today more than ever before. It is critical that during this time of crisis that we adhere to the values of our religion, such as recognizing the human dignity of every soul, irrespective of its religion, geographic location, or any other marker of identity. We need to have empathy with people who are not just halfway across the world whom we can only see through our screens, but we need to empathize with people who are living and working among us. We need to realize that there may be people around us living in our communities who are undergoing immense suffering, such as a neighbor down the street with three little boys who has lost her husband to cancer, or your second grader's classmate who recently lost his mother, or coworkers undergoing health, marital, or financial struggle. The tribulations that confront our ummah should not signal a suspension of our moral accountability. We have the responsibility now, more than ever before, to step up to the plate and to provide relief to those who need it. And by relief, I don't just mean humanitarian aid, but I mean faraj. And what I mean by faraj is relief regardless of the nature of those needs. In one hadith, the Prophet, peace be upon him, informs us that the most beloved people in the eyes of God are those who are most helpful to others, and that the most beloved actions to God is to bring happiness into the heart of a believer, or to remove a grievance he or she is facing, or to pay off another's debt, or quench his or her hunger. And then the Prophet, peace be upon him, tells us that it is more beloved to him to walk down a path with his brother or sister and help him or her fulfill their need than to spend an entire month in i'tikaf at the masjid. And this is a long hadith, but he also reminds us that whoever restrains his anger, God conceals his flaws. And especially when one restrains their anger when they are in a position to unleash it, God will fill his heart with contentment on the day of judgment. And in that regard, we must look to the greatest teacher sent to mankind, Muhammad ibn Abdullah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It was nothing but his empathy and love for humanity that led him to forgive the people of Ta'if in the most demoralizing, emotionally devastating moment of his life. This was a period that Islamic historians call Am al-Huzn, the year of sadness. He had lost two of the most beloved people to him, his wife Khadija radiallahu anha and his uncle Abu Talib. And I apologize for this digression, but a few words must be said about both Khadija and Abu Talib, because we often take these facts for granted in our community. We must recognize the role that Khadija radiallahu anha had played in his life to the extent that he continued to remember her until the last moments of his life, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. She was not only a wife, but a solid rock of support who morally and spiritually uplifted him and even financially provided for him. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam never felt he was less of a man for that, for being financially and emotionally supported by his wife, for being married to a divorcee who was also 15 years his senior. And he never married another woman while he was married to her, despite the prevalent custom of multiple marriages in 7th century Arabia. And we must not forget these facts when we claim that we take the Prophet, peace be upon him, as our role model. And as for Abu Talib, historical accounts report that he never embraced Islam, and yet the Prophet continued to have the utmost respect and affection for his uncle. He didn't shun him or look down upon him. And as Dr. Sherman Jackson taught me through his eloquent narration of the prophetic seerah, if any of you have attended Alim, the American Learning Institute for Muslims, it's a program that takes place in Michigan every summer, you have heard Sherman Jackson's eloquent rendition of the seerah. But the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did not treat people on the basis of their religion, but on the basis of their character. And based on historical accounts, when the Prophet, peace be upon him, went to Ta'if during this demoralized state, After having lost both Khadija and Abu Talib, he was beaten by rocks and chased out of the city by children and servants of the people of Ta'if. And yet, even in the state, when the angel came down to him and gave him the opportunity to seek vengeance by causing the two mountains on the side of Ta'if to crush the city, he still, salatu wasalam alayh, found the mercy and compassion within him to forgive them. And he asked that they be given respite that for perhaps some of his progeny will later be guided, even if they rejected him. And if we look to the Prophet ﷺ as our example, we need to ask ourselves, what was it that prevented him from seeking revenge against those who physically hurt him, against those who spiritually rejected the message with which he had been sent? God tells us, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Al-Anbiya, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ, and that he only sent the Prophet, peace be upon him, as a mercy to mankind. And what made him a mercy to mankind was his empathy with humanity. He was a living embodiment of compassion and concern for the transient and eternal welfare of humanity. And it was that kind of sincerity that penetrated people's hearts, awakened their conscience, and created social transformation. To finalize, we need to seek moral and ethical consistency in all aspects of our lives. We must begin with reforming our own souls, with crushing our egos, with getting rid of the rancor, resentment, and envy that divides our ranks and hearts. If we have truly internalized the reality of our meeting with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then our motive for everything we do should stem from our desire to please Him and nothing else. Let us remind ourselves first and foremost of this, and as well as our children, when we teach them this religion. Our religion is not obsessed with putting everyone in his or her place, but it is about preparing the soul for its ultimate meeting with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and its ultimate return to its creator. Thank you very much. Assalamu alaikum.
JazakAllah khair. Thank you very much. Moving along in our program. Even though we are one multinational, multi-ethnic, multi-racial ummah, every single one of us, that's one of the beauties of being Muslim today, is that I can walk into any masjid in any country in the world and feel at home. I pray. I can see anyone from any country and immediately see him or her as my sister or as my brother. Nevertheless, please forgive me in showing a little and thanking Allah and showing a little bit of pride that there is an American who taught at the Azhar University. And it's special to me as an American. I was born in America, and at the same time, my ancestry is from Egypt. So the fact that there was an American Azhari teaching at Al-Azhar makes me especially grateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's why I'm very humbled and honored to introduce our next guest, Sheikh Yasir Fahmy, who is an American Azhari who taught at Al-Azhar University. Please join me in welcoming Sheikh Yasir Fahmy.
Bismillah, walhamdulillah, wa salatu wa salamu ala rasulillah, wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa man wala, wa la hawla wa la quwwata illa billah, wa la hawla wa la quwwata illa billah, wa la hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. Alhamdulillah, alladhi hadana li hadha, wa ma kunna linahtadiya lawla an hadana Allah. Alhamdulillah, alladhi manna alayna bin ni'amin la tu'addu wa la tuhsa. Alhamdulillah, alwahidu al-ahad. الفرد الصمد الذي لم يلد ولم يولد ولم يكن له كفوا أحد. It's an absolute honor and pleasure to be here this evening, to be alongside such great teachers who have really guided this ummah through many hard times. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be pleased with them all and increase them in goodness. And may they be in the blessed presence of our beloved messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Brothers and sisters, it's an absolute blessing to be present together this evening. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this dunya has gifted us with so many blessings. The fact that we have health, we have safety, we have comfort, that we're able to fly across the country and come together and see all of these beautiful faces, that's a tremendous blessing. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed us with iman and Islam. Allah has blessed us with clothing and food and drink. He's blessed us with His book, the Quran, the ultimate source of guidance. And He has blessed us with خَيْرُ خَلْقِ اللَّهِ كُلِّهِمِ our beloved Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَإِن تَعُدُّ نِعْمَةَ اللَّهِ لَا تُحْصُوهَا. If you were to try to enumerate the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you could never do so. But just as we are believers who recognize the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that one of the features of this dunya is that we will have many blessings, we also realize full well that a fundamental feature in this dunya is that we will face many challenges. And all too often what happens is that we're not really excited about talking about our challenges. We think that by discussing our challenges, we're bringing over our heads a dark cloud. So sometimes we prefer to just sweep it under the rug because it feels better. If I just turn a blind eye, I won't have to deal with it. But the reality is, brothers and sisters, that the believer is someone who knows how to place his or her challenges square in front of their eyes and grab them by their metaphorical horns. To understand that Allahu Jalla Jalaluhu, He is the one who has designated this. And so our duty as His humble servants is to figure out how do we navigate our challenges. As Sister Hadia mentioned, there are serious challenges that we're facing. We're facing serious philosophical challenges. There are all sorts of isms that have become the new religion. Scientism is a new religion. It's no longer just a tool to explore the natural world, but rather a religion that identifies people's philosophical outlook. Consumerism, individualism, secular humanism, these are all serious, quote-unquote, religions in our day and age. Ones that we have to struggle to make sense of and reconcile with our own religion. This is precisely the type of challenges that our young people are facing every single day. Going to school, going to work, having to navigate this very challenging world. We have spiritual challenges that are very real. People who find it very challenging and difficult to connect with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Who hear day in and day out in their masajid about the beauty of Allah and the mercy of Allah. But at home, they're not able to connect to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They're not able to look at the beloved and feel overwhelmed in His beauty. Serious spiritual challenges that we face. We face political challenges that are very real. We see them every single day. We have abominations such as ISIS causing havoc in the world. We have our brothers and sisters in Syria being washed up on shores. Devastating sights that tear our hearts apart. But these are realities of this dunya. Challenges that we see every single day. And the list goes on. The list goes on of the many challenges that you and I are fully aware of. So the question is very simple. How do we navigate this world? How do we make sense of what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has decreed in this dunya? How do we find clarity amidst confusion? And to do that, brothers and sisters, we have to turn to the best of guides. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنَةٌ. That verily in the person of your beloved messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, do you have the best of guides? And the article fi, when used, it infers a profound inness, meaning everything about the beloved sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is of good guidance to you. And so if you want a serious story of resilience, you turn to the life of our beloved sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And I want to share with you just one moment before we leave the stage to those who deserve to be speaking. In the beginning of revelation, see, before revelation came, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was in Mecca. And he was a part of the Meccan high society, if you will. He was loved, cared for. He was married to Lady Khadija. He had, quote unquote, everything you could ask for. He had the envy of all envies, our mother Khadija. He had social capital. They had just rebuilt the Kaaba and he placed the black stone with his own two hands. But although those were his realities, he was still seeking. Allah tells us in Surah Al-Duha, وَوَجَدَكَ ضَالًا فَهَدَى. We found you seeking, Ya Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and we guided you. And so the Prophet ﷺ, he began to enjoy to go where? غار حراء. التحنث في غار حراء. وحبب إليه ذلك. He began to love to go towards غار حراء and spend time with his creator. For some narrations say months, some say years, but nonetheless, that became where he was seeking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Until that one majestic night. And I want us to really think about the beloved sallallahu alayhi wasallam as he's seeking his own guidance. He's seeking his own clarity. He's in the cave of Hira, and the angel Jibreel alayhi salam descends upon our beloved sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And as we all know, he grasps our beloved. The Prophet ﷺ says, فَأَخَذَنِي فَضَمَّنِي حَتَّى بَلَغَنِي الْجَهْدِ. He grabbed me and he took me close to him until I thought that I was going to go faint. And then the command is there. This is the initial moment of revelation. The angel Jibreel commands him and he says, اقرأ. What is the first response of our beloved messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam in the face of revelation? Think about this. The first initial response that the Prophet has in the face of guidance, in the face of revelation, is to say, مَا أَنَا بِقَارِئٍ. I am not one who knows how to fulfill this command. Because Imam Abu Hamid al-Ghazali, he says that al-qira'atu qira'atan, that the reading that we are to do is of two types. قِرَاءَةٌ لِكِتَابِ اللَّهِ الْمَسْطُورِ وَقِرَاءَةٌ لِكِتَابِ اللَّهِ الْمَنْظُورِ. It is to read the book of Allah that is written, that we have in our hands, and the book of Allah that is seen with our eyes. So in actuality, what the Prophet ﷺ is negating his capacity to do is to read the dunya, to read what is preceding him. That is a very powerful notion, that in the face of guidance and revelation, the Prophet enters into complete submission in the majesty of his Lord. And that is the first step on the pathway towards attaining any form of guidance or clarity in this dunya. So the Prophet ﷺ once again is grasped by the angel Jibreel. And the angel Jibreel commands him once again, اقرأ. And the Prophet says, مَا أَنَا بِقَارِئ. A third time. And some of our scholars, they say something very beautiful, that the fact that the Prophet ﷺ is being grasped the way that he was to eliminate himself completely from the equation. And there is a very powerful notion here, that the Prophet, in those initial moments of revelation, he's experiencing a lot of pain. This is a powerful inference to indicate that in growth, or in guidance, or in attaining any form of salvation, you have to experience pain. See, many postmodern philosophers, they want us to think that pain is something that's ugly that you run away from. But a religious disposition says pain is real and pain is to be embraced. And we grow through pain and we experience pain in our growth. And so the Prophet ﷺ, he experiences that in that initial moment in the face of guidance and revelation. So what then was the key? The Prophet now, he submitted completely to the decree of Allah, the command of Iqra. But now he has to proceed. What then was the key that was given? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reveals to the angel Jibreel, اقرأ بسم ربك الذي خلق. Read in the name of your Lord, the one who has created you. See, ya Muhammad, you won't be able to understand or navigate this world unless you do it through a divine lens. If we as human beings think that our ego will guide us through this world, then we are deluded. The only way to make sense of this world, the only way to navigate it successfully, is by reading it in the name of Allah. It is by becoming theocentric people, where Allah is center, not us. All too often, we don't know how to deal with our challenges because our egos are so large. We question things as if we understand. But for this, for Allah, this is a simple creation. The dunya is a simple creation, and we are simple creations in that creation. And so to navigate it in any meaningful way, there has to be complete submission. And there has to be بِسْمِ رَبِّكَ الَّذِي خَلَقْ. By the name of your Lord, the one who's created you, the one who's taught you what you know. And the scholars, when they come to assess the letter ba in Bismi Rabbik, the letter ba, according to the ulama of Balagha, has many meanings. And from the meanings is that al-ba'u lil-isti'ana, ba, the ba here, the letter ba is for aid. Ba'un lil-baraka, as Ibn Juzay says, ba for baraka, for blessings from Allah. So really, to navigate this world, you have to do it by the aid of Allah, by the baraka, by the blessings from Allah, and in the name of Allah, then we can begin to proceed in this world. And so after that initial moment, the Prophet ﷺ, where does he go? He goes straight to the arms of his beloved Khadija. And she brings him close. And the Prophet ﷺ says, إِنِّي أَخَافُ عَلَى نَفْسِي, I fear for myself. She says, لَا تَخَفْ, لَا يُخْزِيكَ اللَّهُ أَبَدًا, don't be fearful, Allah will never betray you. إِنَّكَ لَتَصِلُ الرَّحْمِ وَتَحْمِلُ الْكَلِّ وَتَكْسِبُ الْمَعْدُومِ وَتُعِينُ عَلَى نَوَائِبُ الدَّهْرِ, you are a good man. See, Khadija knew to have great hope in Allah. She said, you are a man who takes care of the needy, you help the destitute, you strengthen the bonds of kinship. You're a good person. Trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He will never betray you. See, that's a very powerful station in this regard. That first you enter into complete submission to the decree of Allah, but then simultaneously you have a profound trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That you know Allah is the most wise, He is the most great, and that He knows what's best for us. So you have trust in what your Creator is decreeing for you. And then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and in closing, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as we all know, is cloaked. He is placed in a cloak. He's comfortable in the embrace of his beloved wife. And so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reveals, Ya ayyuhal muzzammil, qum. Ya ayyuhal muddathir, qum. That's now the operative mode of the believer. See, you understood now. You understood the equation. It's to submit to your Creator. Make Allah center in your life. Have trust in Allah. And then stand up and proceed. قُمْ قُمِ اللَّيْلَ إِلَّا قَلِيلًا, stand and connect to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the darkness of the night. وَرَتِّلِ الْقُرْآنَ تَرْتِيلًا, and recite the book of Allah, تَرْتِيلًا, perfect your recitation of the book. Make sure that it's a regular dose in your life, that you are constantly connected to the guidance of Allah. Make sure that the Qur'an is always present. وَرَتِّلِ الْقُرْآنَ تَرْتِيلًا, Allah says, إِنَّ سَنُلْقِي عَلَيْكَ قَوْلًا ثَقِيلًا, we're going to place upon you a heavy load, a heavy word. And so the only way you're going to be able to carry this load successfully is by doing it with the aid of Allah, being connected to Allah. So brothers and sisters, the message is very simple. If we have any hope in truly navigating, and we didn't answer any of the major philosophical questions, but what I wanted to give is the beginning. How do we begin the journey of succeeding in dealing with the challenges of our time? It begins with complete submission to your Creator. Embracing the guidance that Allah has given us in the Quran, in the embodiment of our beloved Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, turning to them and having complete trust that they know how to be guided in this world. And we submit to it no matter how much pain we may experience in that regard. And to know full well that Allah sees us. And Allah is telling us, be patient, fasbir sabran jameela, beautify yourself and engage in a beautiful patience so that you may be able to navigate this world. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us patience in navigating the world that is in front of us. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us clarity to understand what is expected of us, to give us hikmah, understanding, wisdom in our deen, to make us of those who find their ultimate comfort in their submission to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to be of those whose hearts are connected to the beloved Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, to be amongst those who yearn to be in the presence of our beloved Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, to be gifted a sip from the basin of our beloved Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and to be in the highest levels of Jannah with our beloved Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Wa akhiru da'wana an alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen.
Jazakallah khair, Sheikh Yasir Fahmy. You know, I was, again, the hashtag is ISNA52Chicago. And so I tweeted how excited I was and honored to be sharing the stage with these giants. And I almost jumped up and down in giddiness when Dr. Mattson retweeted my tweet. It was, wow, I had to hold myself back. So our next speaker is Dr. Ingrid Mattson. Again, does not need an introduction. She's the London and Windsor Community Chair of Islamic Studies at Huron University College at the University of Western Ontario in London, Canada. And she's also the former president of ISNA. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Ingrid Mattson.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين السلام عليكم brothers and sisters. I'm mindful of the fact that many of you came here today most likely because you're facing some hardship or difficulty. Some of you might have a husband or wife who are in the middle or late stages of dementia or Alzheimer's. Others of you may have a sick child or a child who has special needs that are very taxing on the family. Others, probably many others, have family members who are now under the threat of violence, under bombs and marauding violent people, trying to flee that situation. Others are facing very deep and personal struggles. So what I want to say first is that, you know, we all are here because we love you and we care about you, and we want to have a community that is more present for you and for your families. And when we talk about tests and trials, we have to remember that any one person's test is a test for all of us. Because it's not only a test for the person who is facing that illness or war or hardship, but for all of us, how do we respond? How are we responding to those around us who are suffering? Do we even know that they're suffering? We might have good knowledge of those in our family or our close friends and neighbors, but what about everyone else who quietly are suffering? This requires a collective commitment to love and care and compassion and concern in the community. When the father of Joseph, Sayyidina Yaqub, alayhi salam, when he was in the midst of his suffering, he called Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala arham ar-rahameen, the most merciful of the ones who have mercy. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was sent rahmatan lil alameen, and of course Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is ar-rahman ar-rahim. If we want to be a community that truly is seeking the face of the Most High, we need to strive for mercy and compassion in our community. And that needs to be done not just haphazardly, but it needs to be done in a serious collective way. Any collective obligation requires true organization. And I think this is a place where we are failing at this moment. We live in a society that no one's fault, it's just the way things are, is that people are very mobile, they move around from, community to community, for jobs and for school. We're just really disconnected from each other, and we can't rely on informal, accidental encounters with people who are in need to take care of the needs of our community anymore. We really need to be more organized. All of our masajid should have, either muakha or social, friendship groups or something where we go out and find the people who need help and we help them. I train and have trained for many years chaplains, Muslim chaplains who are working in the community, in hospitals, in colleges. And one of the things that, the first things that they learn is that people who are suffering don't need your cheap advice. And you may think this is, this isn't the proper word to use if you're saying something like, this is a test. Allah only tests those, who can bear it. But honestly, in most cases, this is just cheap advice. That is a way for you to feel that you've somehow, dispensed with your obligation to interact with this person without actually doing something. So what they need is, they don't even need, let me know if I can do anything. They need, what can I do for you? And to give a few specific suggestions. Can I bring you some food? Can I come and visit? Can I come stay with your child so that you can go out and do other things? We really need to learn how to care for each other because we don't live in a kind of natural world anymore. We don't even know how to be good neighbors and how to truly help people. So, I'm really beginning with this because I know many, it's not that we're hard-hearted. It's just that we don't have the systems in place, the natural systems in place anymore to really take care of each other. And we need to do much better than we have been doing up to now. For me, in my life, I think the story that has probably saved me again and again is the story that is found in the Quran, Surat Yusuf, the story of Joseph, not Sayyidina Yusuf alayhi salam, but really his father, maybe because I'm a parent. Of course, Sayyidina Yusuf goes through all sorts of hardship and difficulty, and he grows through this, and we see the wisdom behind all of it. But I am always struck, and this is why I continually return to Surat Yusuf again and again, to see this story through the eyes of the father of Joseph, who begins with this terrible sense of anxiety and foreboding. Anyone who has children knows this, that you can never, right, what's the saying? Anyone who has children can never truly be happy again. Your heart is always just has this little piece of anxiety and seeing something coming and being worried and giving advice and trying to do what you can, but of course, whatever the qadr of Allah is, this will happen. Qadr Allah wa mashafa'al. It's the first thing I learned about Islam before I was a Muslim. My friends from Senegal told me this when I was so sad at leaving their company after having such blessed company with them. And they said, Qadr Allah wa mashafa'al. And I'll never forget that, that we have to accept whatever destiny Allah has written for us. And I think Qadr is the kind of forgotten pillar of faith. We don't teach it well enough. And we need to prepare. Part of being able to survive through hardship and difficulty is being prepared for it. We can't just avoid the fact that there is good and bad in Qadr. We need to be prepared for that. We need to understand it. And rather than just be deceived and try to protect our children from every hardship that there will ever be. So we need to understand that. And when we see Sayyidina Yaqub, may Allah be pleased with him, having this anxiety and then seeing this whole tragedy in his eyes unfold. The beautiful thing about him and why I find him an incredible role model is that he shows us something. He's a prophet. He's one of the chosen messengers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But what we see in him is that faith is not the opposite of sadness. You know, faith and sadness, faith and anxiety, faith and anger even, are not in opposition or in conflict. We see that Sayyidina Yaqub has absolute faith and trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala throughout the whole story, while at the same time experiencing deep, deep sadness. He cries to the point that he loses his sight. You know, this world has been a world of such, it is a lying world. You know, beginning with the shirt and what his son say, everything, all the signs on the outside are lying. And this is why he turns to the inner world. He loses his sight from crying, and he becomes angry, qadim. He has huzn, he has anger, but he also says this incredible thing. He says, wa'alam min Allahi ma la ta'alamun. I know something from Allah that you don't know. And this really is the secret of suffering. This is the secret of hardship and suffering and difficulty, is that you will learn something. And learning is the reason for suffering. Through this different state that we land in, we learn something new that we could never have known before. And it's something that will bring us to a level and a state and a closeness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that would have been impossible without it. If you think you know what love is, have a child, and have a child who suffers terribly from an illness and you lose that child, you will realize that you had no idea what love is. That feeling you have for that child, who you are losing and then who you've lost. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is al-wadud. Now you know something about love. Not just at a quantitative level, but a qualitative level that is completely different than anything you could have known otherwise. Allah is the just. We think we know what justice is. Wait until you are in a situation where there is no justice around you. You are the victim and subject to extreme injustice. You will know what justice is in a way that someone deprived of it in this situation could never know. And that brings you closer to the one who is the source of justice. So all of these situations we are in are ways to learn something about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as the absence of, or the absence of goodness makes us desire keenly the source of goodness, the source of love, the source of compassion. So knowledge is really the key and the secret, but it's not easy. And it's not something that we should consider, you know, in a trivial way. And we should never advise people or judge people, you know, why are you crying? Don't be sad. You know, you should just have patience. This way, the father of Joseph had great patience. He is the one who said this beautiful statement, sabru jameen, patience is beautiful. But he also said, what all did he also say? He said, I complain of my sadness and grief to Allah. He had sadness and grief at the same time. So you don't feel that you've lost faith if you're experiencing this. You can have both at the same time, and they're two sides of the coin, and you hold on to it, and then you move to this statement in your mind and you say, what am I to learn from this? What is Allah asking me to learn now in this situation? The other thing is that, and part of learning is to say, one door is blocked, or I've lost something. But because I have lost something, or because one path is blocked, what is opened up for me now? that would have been impossible if all of this didn't happen. You know, we see again in the story of Yusuf alayhi salam, he would never have landed in Egypt and been there to help and benefit the people, and also to be able to demonstrate and to show, to be a sign to all humanity, a sign of goodness and knowledge and insight and integrity and reconciliation that he engages with in his family. None of that would have happened without the initial violations that took place against him. So something is closed to him, but another path is opened. And so we have to look at that. What is open to me now? My other hero, the heroic person, a great person in human history, in Islamic history, is the person who really we could say is the founder of Mecca, and that is Hajar. May Allah be pleased with her. Her story and her struggle is gives me such hope, and it gives me such courage. And it's why all of us are required to imitate her running on our pilgrimage. We are all required to imitate that struggle. And she, again, has this perfect, beautiful combination of absolute, absolute faith that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will get her out of this situation, yet at the same time putting enormous effort into resolving the situation. And what's amazing is that she thinks that her salvation will come from one point, but it comes from something else. The reason she's running back and forth between the tops of the mountains is because those are the highest places in the land. And from there, she can look around and see if anyone's coming. She thinks her salvation will come from people who will come and bring water and provisions. But instead, because of her effort, when the Prophet Muhammad narrates her story, he said she ran kal majhud, she was making this great effort, this great struggle. This is what she had, is this struggle between these mountains, trying to save her and save her child. Yet Allah did save her, but saved her from a place she never could have imagined, in a way she could never have imagined, and in a way that not only saved her, but allowed for the settlement of that area. It is because of that and the water that sprung up for her and her child that people then were able to permanently settle in that location, because previously there was no water there. You cannot settle where there's not any water. And she was the matriarchal founder of that city. She kept the water rights. She let people settle, but she kept the water rights. So here she is, and what's interesting about both these stories is that these are two people, Sayyidina Yusuf and Sayyidina Hajar, who had to go to another land to have their conflict resolved and to live out their destiny as people who would do something great for the world and whose own situation of struggle and hardship would be resolved. And that shows that this, being a Muslim, the story of Islam is deeply entwined with migration, with fleeing, with seeking refuge, and going to other lands. This is an integral part of us. The Prophet Muhammad, he had to flee to another land to be safe, and all the early Muslims. The founding of Mecca is based on a woman who had to flee to another land, a land of hardship. We see this again and again. This is part of the Islamic story. And so it's part of the story that we should narrate also to our children and to each other, to remind each other that this is something that will be our fate, probably the fate of most of us or many of us, and we need to understand it and embrace it and know what to do about it. So when we find ourselves in the situation of great difficulty, we then say, is it two? We say, what am I supposed to do now? What am I supposed to learn now? And what, now that certain paths have been blocked to me, what am I now free to do? What am I now free to do? When I meet a couple who tells me that they are struggling and sad because they've tried to have children and they don't have children. I say to the woman, Mashallah, you are in the state of Aisha, Umm al-Mu'mineen, may Allah be pleased with her. This is a special state. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose for many of Umm al-Hatim al-Mu'mineen not to have children. Why? Only Allah knows, but we see that because they were not busy with their own children, they were able to be mothers to the community. They were able to be the founders of much of the knowledge, the systems of knowledge in our community. All of the things that they were freed to do. When you see, if you yourself are a Muslim who is single, to look at this only as an absence is missing the opportunity to see what is open to you. If you are not married or cannot marry because of health reasons, because of your sexuality perhaps, and it's not lawful for you to engage in intimacy with the people you desire, perhaps Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has chosen for you something better. And that may be to take the human need for love and intimacy and to give love to other people by being able to serve many who someone who's married and at home with children can't. When I was growing up, the nuns of my community, the Roman Catholic sisters, were able to be in taking care of orphans, to go to the hospitals at night, to go with the homeless people day and night, to be on call any time, day or night, when someone was in need. Maybe that is what Allah has chosen for you, because it would not be possible or would be very difficult for someone who is married with children at home to go and provide that service to the community. So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chooses for you a certain path, we should never look at it only as a loss, despite the fact that it may still be difficult. This is not saying it will not be painful or hard or challenging, but we need to understand that Allah has destined for all of us a path and that there are special circumstances, and as a community, we are filled with people who are able to do some things and unable to do others. And for every deficit, there is another way of doing, another way of seeing, another way of being in the world from which we can learn. We all need to value those differences, and we also, ourselves, our own spiritual struggle is to look deeply, not at our lives as a series of losses, but as a series of opportunities to do something now. The Prophet Muhammad said, whenever you see someone who has more, look to someone who has less. Service to others is the best way to carry your suffering and carry your difficulty and manage it in a way that you are able to continue forward and find that opportunity to do something good in the world. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless all of you and to give you strength and support and wisdom and insight and knowledge so that you may understand and we all may understand what Allah has chosen for us and do the best in that situation. Assalamu alaikum.
JazakAllah khair. Thank you, Dr. Mattson. As a moderator, it's very hard not to be starstruck and just sit there and be like, wow, and then forget that I have to actually keep the program going. So it's kind of, so alhamdulillah. The next speaker is someone who does not need introduction, Imam Zaid Shakir. I consider him to be one of my teachers, and I am blessed to have been able to learn from him, and most of us, if not all of us, I feel the same way. Please join me in welcoming Imam Zaid Shakir.
Assalamu بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على سيد المرسلين سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Okay, I had an earlier session and I'm going to open this one the same way. Before we go any further, huh? She's on the phone. Alhamdulillah. It's all good. Listen, before we go any further, I just want everyone to smile. Just smile. SubhanAllah. It's easy to do. It's sadaqah. You just gave a little charity to yourself and to others. It's smile. Everything's okay. Allah Ta'ala is still on the job. Don't worry about it. It's all good. Alhamdulillah. Several years ago, I went to, it's the only time actually, I went to the conference of the American Academy of Religion because it was in San Francisco and I was in Oakland and it was only across the bridge, so I had no excuse not to go. And then they had the Zaytuna College session, even though at that point there was no Zaytuna College, but how do you figure? So we went, and I'm going from session to session to session to session, and I'm looking for all these wonderful theological insights from this vast array of religious scholars who representing so many of the major religions in this country, including Islam. And every session that I went to was totally void of any theological insights. There weren't even any theological discussions. Every session I went to, literally, it was Foucault and Derrida. 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 So I'm thinking, like, these must be really great theologians who are on the tongue of every student of theology or every scholar of theology in America. And so, you know, I dug into who are these characters? And Foucault was an avowed atheist. And Derrida, 2 years before his death, he said he could reasonably pass as an atheist at the American Academy of Religion in Toronto, which is fitting for Derrida because neither he nor anyone else knows what that means. And he spent his career deconstructing meaning. The bottom line, Foucault and Derrida will never lead you to God. One who does not even believe in God will never lead you to God. And every Muslim student of religion and theology should internalize that to the depth and the core of their being. Otherwise, you will contribute to leading people away from God. That's the bottom line. Derrida will never lead you to God because God is ultimate meaning. The people who have laid out for us the path of spiritual life and the path of spiritual progress, foundational to the entire enterprise, is that there are two things in this creation. There is his, there is physical reality, and there is mana, and there's meaning. And someone who doesn't advocate any system or a traditional system of meaning will never lead you to meaning. And without meaning, you cannot know God. Without meaning, you cannot know God. That's the bottom line. And without belief in God, you can't know God. And without certainty, and certainty tends to negate the whole idea of relativism, you cannot know God. Without certainty, you can't lead people. Allah Ta'ala mentions in Quran, وَجَعَلْنَا مِنْهُمْ أَئِمَّةً يَهْدُونَ بِأَمْرِنَا لَمَّا صَبَرُوا وَكَانُوا بِآيَاتِنَا يُوقِنُونَ, that we made them leaders, referring to the prophets of Bani Israel, but generally a principle for leadership in a society, who guided by our command after they patiently persevered, and they were absolutely certain concerning our signs. They had absolute certainty concerning our signs. Now, I don't want to talk about all that. I want to talk about something in this verse, patience. Dr. Mattson talked about it, sabrun jameel. Yaqoubi bore the tribulations he was faced with because he was able to persevere and he was able to wait and he was able to see how things unfolded in a most beautiful way. In a most beautiful way. Patience is one of the ways we tap into a higher reality. I think that's the theme of the how do we tap into a higher power. One way we do it is patience. And when this is mentioned in the Quran, think of the context, because we see many of the forces arrayed against Muslims as being overwhelming. They're just awesomely overwhelming. The forces of worldly power, the forces of the media that just convey one negative story after another, magnify things, twist things, distort things, anything to make Islam look bad, anything to demoralize the Muslims. Overwhelming, the situation in the Middle East. The stupidity of Muslims, overwhelming stupidity, just fall into trap after trap, time after time after time, constantly being bitten in the same snake hole. Overwhelming. But how do you overcome overwhelming odds? Allah Ta'ala tells us exactly how you do it. كَمْ مِنْ فِيَةٍ قَلِيلَةٍ غَلَبَتْ فِيَةً كَثِيرَةً بِإِذْنِ اللَّهِ وَاللَّهُ مَعَ الصَّابِرِينَ. How many times has a smaller group overcome a larger group? How many times have those who are overwhelmed by the size and the numbers arrayed against them overcome? Through patience. Wallahu ma'a sabirin. Abu Talib Mekki in his classic, Kut al-Qulub, he says, Man kana Allahu ma'ahu ghalaba. One who Allah is with will be victorious, will win out. That's, if Allah is with us, who can be against us? Wallahu ma'a sabirin. But Allah isn't with just anyone. Allah says He's with those who are patient. He is with those who persevere. He is with those who just keep going. They keep going. They keep working. They keep working and they have the ability to wait. There's no rush. There's no rush. Things unfold in Allah's time. And at the end, things will be all right. وَالْعَقِبَةُ لِلْمُتَّقِينَ. Things are going to be all right, brothers and sisters. Don't despair. In the story of Yusuf that Dr. Mattson referenced, the advice that Yaqub gave his sons when he sent them back into Egypt, وَلَا تَيْأَسُوا مِنْ رَوْحِ اللَّهِ إِنَّهُ لَا يَيْأَسُوا مِنْ رَوْحِ اللَّهِ إِلَّا الْقَوْمُ الْكَافِرُونَ. Don't despair of being relieved by Allah. Don't despair of Allah's mercy. Only a disbelieving people despair of relief or mercy, however you translate rawh, which encompasses all of those meanings. Only this is a sign of a disbelieving person. We're not saying some believer who might despair is a disbeliever, but this is one of the characteristics of a disbelieving person, because they don't have the certainty that Allah is with them. They don't have the certainty that Allah has power over all things. To go back to Foucault and Derrida, some people might say, but they help us to understand power and oppressive hierarchies. And they can also help us to become so focused on the worldly means of power that we forget the ultimate statement concerning power. وَلَا حَوْلَ وَلَا قُوَّةَ إِلَّا بِاللَّهِ. There's no strength, ultimately, and there's no power except with Allah. وَلَا حَوْلَ وَلَا قُوَّةَ إِلَّا بِاللَّهِ. قُلِ اللَّهُمَّ مَالِكَ الْمُلْكِ تُؤْتِي الْمُلْكَ مَنْ تَشَاءُ وَتَنْزِعُ الْمُلْكَ مِمَّنْ تَشَاءُ وَتُعِزُّ مَنْ تَشَاءُ وَتُذِلُّ مَنْ تَشَاءُ بِيَدِكَ الْخَيْرُ إِنَّكَ عَلَى كُلِّ شَيْءٍ قَدِيرٌ. Ya Allah, the possessor of all dominion and power, you give it to whom you please, you withdraw it from whom you please, whomsoever you please, you elevate whomsoever you please, you debase whomsoever you please. Verily, in your hand is all good. Verily, you over all things have power. Verily, you over all things have power. So, brothers and sisters, be patient. Keep working. In the context of the situation we find ourselves in, we're blessed. So when you think Islamophobia is bad, just step back and thank Allah that it's not so bad you're jumping into the Atlantic Ocean trying to make it to Europe to catch some relief from it. It's bad at the level of words. Muslims aren't being killed wholesale in this country. Muslims aren't even being killed retail in this country. There's the tragedy of the Dia and Yusr and her sister, no doubt. But Muslims aren't being killed like African Americans are being shot down in the street like dogs. Like Trayvon Martin, or Michael Brown, or Tamir Gray, or Sean Bell, Ahmadou Diallo, or in Oakland, Gary King, or Oscar Grant, handcuffed, face down on the train platform. That's not happening to Muslims. So it's at the level of words that's causing so much agitation. And what does Allah say? At that level, لَتُبْلَوُنَّ فِي أَمْوَالِكُمْ أَنفُسِكُمْ وَلَتَسْمَعُنَّ مِنَ الَّذِينَ أُوتُوا الْكِتَابَ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ وَمِنَ الَّذِينَ أَشْرَكُوا أَذًا كَثِيرًا وَإِن تَصْبِرُوا وَتَتَّقُوا فَإِنَّ ذَلِكَ مِنْ عَزْمِ الْأُمُورِ. That you're going to be tested, as was stated. This is the nature of the world. Things are going to muddy up the water. As Ibn Atta'illah says, let us staghrib. وَقُولْ أَكْدَارْ مَا دُمْتَ فِي هَذِهِ الدَّارِ. Don't be surprised by things that muddy up the water, the akdar. As long as you're in this worldly abode. As long as you're in this worldly abode, because it's only manifesting what its deserved description is. مُسْتَحَقٌ وَصْفُهَا. And what is what necessarily follows from its attribute. This is the dunya, the realm of tests, the realm of tribulations, and the akhirah is dar as-salam. The akhirah is the abode where the worldly imperfections and the worldly defects and the worldly tribulations won't exist. Not here. So don't be surprised by these things. Patiently persevere. You're going to be tested in your wealth. لَتُبْلَوُنَّ فِي أَمْوَالِكُمْ. And in your lives. وَأَنفُسِكُمْ. And you're going to hear like you're hearing now when you turn on the radio and you turn on the television. And it's not just Fox anymore. It's across the dial. It's not just the Weekly Standard anymore. It's the New York Times. It's the Atlantic Journal. It's mainstream, and you're going to hear from those given the scripture before you, some of the Jews and Christians, not all of them, there are good people amongst them, and the idolaters, not all of them, some of them, and then kathira, much abuse. You're going to hear much abuse Get used to it. But how do you overcome it? How do you tap into a higher power to draw the strength to overcome it? وَإِن تَصْبِرُوا If you patiently persevere. If you patient, if you are patient, when tasbiru, what tattaqu, and remain mindful of Allah in the good times and the bad times, whether people love us or hate us, we're supposed to be people of taqwa. Whether they're talking about us in nice ways or in nasty ways, we're supposed to be people of taqwa who keep the orders, the commandments and prohibitions of Allah Ta'ala before us, and we respect them and we stop before them. And we lead our lives with a conscious awareness of them. In good times and bad times. In easy times and difficult times. In times of Hakuna Matata. In times of whatever the Swahili opposite of Hakuna Matata is. Maybe some of our Tanzanian brothers and sisters can help us out. وَإِن تَصْبِرُوا وَتَتَّقُوا فَإِنَّ ذَلِكَ مِنْ عَزْمِ الْأُمُورِ That's a manifestation of firmness and resolve in the affair. إِنَّ اللَّهَ مَعَ الصَّابِرِينَ وَاللَّهُ مَعَ الصَّابِرِينَ وَاللَّهُ مَعَ الصَّابِرِينَ This is, brothers and sisters, that's how we tap into the higher power. Just keep going. You're having challenges in your daily life. Push, keep pushing through them. Keep waiting for Allah Ta'ala's relief. Keep anticipating relief from Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala. It's going to come. But again, as Ibn Ta'ala says at the end of one of his aphorisms, فِي وَقْتِ الَّذِي يُرِيدُ وَلَا فِي وَقْتِ الَّذِي تُرِيدُ أَنْتَ But it comes at the time Allah desires, not the time you desire. Because Allah knows best when to send it. So just be patient. And keep waiting. It's coming. And keep smiling. Because that's the way the world is. That's the way the world is going to be. And in relative terms, in this country, we're enjoying some good times. We're enjoying some good times. We're enjoying great times. You know, what time do you want in American history? What time do you want? You want Jim Crow? You want to be an African American during the Jim Crow era? You want slavery? You want the Great Depression? It was easier for people in the Great Depression? What do you want? You want to be a native person marching across the country in the Trail of Tears? You want to be General Custer at the Little Bighorn? Now, what do you want? Or do you want now to be able to assemble in freedom, to be able to declare our faith, to be able to defend ourselves if we stand up and do it. No one stops us. No one stops us. To be able to publish, to be able to all go to the bazaar, to be able to establish all of these incredible businesses. Now, during the era of Islamophobia, we could do more, we could do better, but we have it pretty good in historical terms. You want to be Muslims? Move beyond America. You want to be a Muslim as Genghis Khan and his descendants are marching across the heartland of Islam? You want to be a Muslim then? You want to be a Muslim in Jerusalem when the Crusaders rolled through and killed every Muslim inhabitant of the city? And the blood was up to the ankles and the knees of the soldiers? This is recorded in the annals of their history. Do you want that, brothers and sisters, or do you want what Allah has given us? And Allah has given us good. And the trials and tribulations we do face, just be patient, because Allah is with us if we are patient. Allah is with us if we are patient. And if Allah is with us, no one can be against us. فَمَنْ كَانَ اللَّهُ مَعَهُ غَلَبَ May Allah bless us, bless this gathering. May you have a great weekend. I told you to smile, now I depressed you. So start smiling again. When you're smiling, as the song goes, the whole world smiles with you. The angels, the malaika, all of the worlds smile with you. So smile, keep working, keep persevering, be patient. Allah is with those who are patient, and that's one way we tap into this higher power. Assalamu alaikum.
JazakAllah khair, Imam Zaid, thank you very much. You know, speaking about being starstruck, I first saw our last guest on YouTube. He was being interviewed on television, and I'm like, mashallah, this sheikh is awesome. I mean, he was, mashallah, it was really awesome. And then I'm so blessed to be able to then shake his hand on stage before we started. So I'm like, again, Dr. Mattson retweeted my tweet, and I shook hands with Sheikh Muhammad Yaqoubi. He's our last guest. Please join me in welcoming Sheikh Muhammad Yaqoubi.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Wa sallallahu wa sallama wa baraka ala Sayyidina Muhammad, Khatamin Nabiyyin wa Imamil Mursaleen. وعلى آله الطيبين الطاهرين وصحابته الغر الميامين والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين أما بعد. Brothers and sisters, the best description of the source of our problem today I heard in the beginning of this session from Dr. Hadia, I believe, when she said our problem is spiritual. Yes, indeed, our problem is spiritual. We're facing a lot of challenges, political, economic, individually, on a level of a community, sometimes people get ill, sometimes people fail in their marital life. We're facing a lot of problems. But this is not new. Humanity faced problems all the time. What is new is not being able to cope with our problems and not finding the source of the problem to address it. Our problem is spiritual. Yes, indeed. People can be poor, not having enough wealth. But poverty is no shame. Poverty should not cause any agony. It does when you do not accept it. It does when you are not able to handle it and cope with it. Then, as the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam says, كَادَ الْفَقْرُ أَن يَكُونَ كُفْرًا. Poverty may lead to disbelief sometimes. Anger is leading the ummah now. We're angry at everything. Anger is in no way a source of power or success in any society. We see things happening around us, mainly oppression against Muslims in the world around us, then we burst in anger. This is not the right attitude. Anger can never solve a problem. Anger can go on against everything in this world to reach even against God Himself. When people are not happy with what he decrees or inflicts upon them. We're talking about tapping into power or higher power. I like how Islam handled action and reaction. Because the ummah now has fallen into an endless succession of reactions, which are based on emotional tragedies, traumas. not on planning and thinking. I'm sure you're aware that when people in the past few decades wanted to apply for a job, they had to go through what is known as IQ, standardized intelligence questionnaires. But later, in the past 20 years, 30 years, it became archaic, and it was replaced by EI, emotional intelligence, which is based on your reaction when you're facing a problem. How would you deal with it? Because leadership requires ability to handle a sudden situation. That's leadership. Now, when we look at how Islam trained us through all of the ibadat, through all of the sunnahs of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, and the aspects of his beautiful character, we will see that we are trained in order to absorb, in order to be able to reflect the best aspect of our belief to people, not the worst which we think we're suffering from. One example is the famous hadith in As-Sahihain on sabr, patience. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam was going to visit the graveyard, Al-Baqarah. He passed by a woman sitting at a grave, crying, lamenting the loss of her son. She didn't see the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam or recognize him. She was crying. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam said to her, Ya amat Allah, ittaqi Allah wasbiri. Servant of Allah, have taqwa and have patience. She didn't recognize the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. She said, oh, you've not been tested with my calamities. The companions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam coming behind him told her, this is the messenger of Allah. She was scared. She ran to catch up Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and tell him, Ya Rasulullah, attaqi Allah wa asbir. O messenger of Allah, I will have taqwa and I will have patience. قال إنما الصبر عند الصدمة الأولى. Patience indeed is at first strike. That's patience. Patience indeed is at first strike. Imam Muhyiddin al-Arabi, one of the greatest figures in Islam, wrote a very small work called لا يعول عليه, a book of things which you should never count on. He said, the second patience is never counted upon. It is the first patience, the first expression of patience, not the second, because the second can be contemplated later on. But you would regret your anger in the beginning. You would regret that you were not able to handle the situation. Allah wants from you your first reaction to be regulated by Al-Quran, by As-Sunnah, by the life of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is why he is a good example for us, regulating it. Sayyidina Ali radiyallahu ta'ala explains this and gives a very concrete example. As Imam al-Tabari narrates in the interpretation of the verse on patience, وَلَنَبْلُوَنَّكُمْ بِشَيْءٍ مِّنَ الْخَوْفِ وَالْجُوعِ وَنَقْصٍ مِّنَ الْأَمْوَالِ وَالْأَنفُسِ وَالثَّمَرَاتِ وَبَشِّرِ الصَّابِرِينَ. We will inflict, we will test you with some of fear, hunger, loss of lives and fruits or harvests, yet give glad tidings people of patience. One important here aspect of this verse people forget. There is what is known in the Arabic language, iltifat. Allah is addressing us. We will test you with his authority, ultimate authority. Then he's addressing Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Wabashir, O Muhammad, wabashir ya Muhammad. O Muhammad, give the glad tidings to the people of patience. Why? This turn, iltifat in balagha, rhetorics. Because he, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, was the best example of patience. And you will not be able to teach people patience if you're not a good example of it. And anything else, coupling knowledge with practice. Sayyiduna Ali radiyallahu ta'ala an says, من ضرب كفه بفخذه عند سماع المصيبة فقد حبط ثواب صبره. You know, when we hear something bad, bad news, loss of a son, loss of a parent, loss in business, loss sometimes in exams, people express it in different ways. The most disciplined people would keep their mouth shut, wouldn't say anything bad, but something, they have to say something, they have to do something. So what they do is, they just strike with their hands on their thighs, something like that. Why did it happen? Why me? Something, without words, it's just something like that. Sayyiduna Ali radiyallahu ta'ala an says, anyone who does this, the rewards for his patience are gone. You see patience here, what it means? Patience is not pain-taking. It's not the concept of forbearance as understood in the English language. Patience, as we heard in the description of, in the Quran, فَصَبْرٌ جَمِيلٌ is beautiful because it is based ideologically, theologically, it is based on a principle of belief. فَعَسَىٰ أَن تَكْرَهُوا شَيْئًا وَهُوَ خَيْرٌ لَكُمْ وَعَسَىٰ أَن تُحِبُّوا شَيْئًا وَهُوَ شَرٌ لَكُمْ وَاللَّهُ يَعْلَمُ وَأَنْتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. That's the theological foundation of patience. You may dislike one thing whilst it is good for you, and you may like another whilst it is bad for you. Indeed, Allah knows, not you. You do not. So this is, you start from this. Allah knows what is better for me more than me knowing what is better for myself. That's the basic belief. Then, as a believer in Allah, I know that He won't do for me but good. This is expressed in the hadith of Sahih Muslim when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam says, عَجَبًا لِأَمْرِ الْمُسْلِمِ إِنَّ أَمْرَهُ كُلَّهُ لَهُ خَيْرٍ إِنْ أَصَابَتْهُ سَرَّاءَ شَكَرَ فَكَانَ خَيْرًا لَهُ وَإِنْ أَصَابَتْهُ ضَرَّاءَ صَبَرَ فَكَانَ خَيْرًا لَهُ وَلَيْسَ ذَلِكَ إِلَّا لِلْمُؤْمِنِ. Wondrous is the case of a believer. When he's visited by calamities, he's forbearant. And this is good for him. When he's given bounties, he's thankful. And this is good for him. This is not for other than the believer. So everything that comes from Allah is sweet. If we take the example of sickness, if people know the spiritual state in which you are when you are ill, people would wish to get ill. Of course, we're ordered in the Sharia to make dua, to pray that Allah protect us and Allah keep us safe and healthy. But just see the beauty, how people, when getting ill, they get close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. On the day of judgment, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, addressing one of his servants, قال يا عبدي مرضت فلم تعودني قال يا رب كيف أعودك وأنت رب العباد
قال مرض عبدي فلان فلم تعده ولو عدته لوجدتني عنده.
This is ambiguous, difficult to translate, and we're not allowed from a Sharia point of view to translate ambiguities al-mutashabih literally. It has to be translated metaphorically, as Imam al-Nasafi Mu'inuddin in his Bahru al-Kalam and Imam al-Razi in Asas al-Taqdis. And I said this also for all people who work in translation, translating al-mutashabih, ambiguous words from al-kitab and al-sunnah, the only option we have is interpretation, at-ta'wil. We can't go literally in the translation. So the hand of Allah is above their hands. You can't use it in that way. Yadullahi fawqa aydihim. You have, and the only option to go for is the power of Allah overwhelms their power. So literally here, it means Allah is getting sick, which is very impossible here. But it means here that the person has gotten sick. You have not visited him. Had you visited him, you would have found me there with him. At him. This is a special withness, special state when a sick person is so close to Allah. Imam Ibn Atallah expressed this when he said, Al-faqat busutul mawahib, al-faqat a'yadul muridin. Cases or states of need, when you are weak, when you are tested, when you are visited by calamities, are feasts for those who are journeyers to Allah. We are all journeyers to Allah. Actually, mats on which the divine gifts are given to you. And one important thing is the answer of your dua, especially when the cause of your problems is political and oppression. We know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guaranteed that the dua, the prayer of a person who is oppressed is answered. And this is something that is unique. Even in Musnad Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, one of the many, many beautiful aspects of Islam, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَيَسْتَجِيبُ دَعْوَةَ الْمَظْلُومِ وَلَوْ كَانَ كَافِرًا. Allah answers the prayer of an oppressed person even if he is a non-believer. Because, يَا عِبَادِي إِنِّي حَرَّمْتُ الظُّلْمَ عَلَى نَفْسِي وَجَعَلْتُهُ بَيْنَكُمْ مُحَرَّمًا فَلَا تَظَالَمُوا. In the divine statement, we read, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, O my servants, I made oppression forbidden. Do not oppress each other. But see here, when you're oppressed, then you go back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you extend your hand and your dua is answered on condition that you do not do anything reactionary. Some people come to us and say, well, this person oppressed me, took all my money, I made so much dua against him and nothing happened. Well, because you took revenge. You went around slandering the person, talking ill of him everywhere. How do you expect after doing or taking revenge that your dua is to be answered? You want your dua to be answered? Then hand your affairs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And don't go in this reactionary succession of events where out of anger, out of hatred, you just go and put all of your pain on others. See how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala regulated our reaction. When talking to our parents and how important it is to respect our parents and obey them, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us, وَلَا تَقُلْ لَهُمَا أُفٍ وَلَا تَنْهَرْهُمَا وَقُلْ لَهُمَا قَوْلًا كَرِيمًا. And do not say to them, "Uff," to your parents. Who would say uff? By the way, uff in the Arabic language is a puzzling word. Is a puzzling word. Literally, go to Tajul Arus, the largest sub-commentary of dictionary, largest Arab dictionary. You'll see that it has 50 different ways of pronunciation, according to Imam al-Zabidi. But no one says uff. Well, people say it. That's the first reaction. If you're the most polite son or daughter to your parents, the most obedient, but still they ask you to do something you do not like, you keep silent, but you exhale in anger. (Sighs) That's ism sawt in the Arabic language. That's the expression of an exhale which is made into uff, regulated. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling you that you should not even say uff, you should not express your resentment to anything your parents ask you to do, even not with an exhale, a sigh, or something. Even that least expression. Why? To regulate your response, your reaction, so that you always think before you do. And this is how Muslims and what Muslims should develop their style of work. Our problems, as I started, are spiritual. And they won't be solved unless, brothers and sisters, we go back to discover the wealth of spirituality in Islam. And this involves from us digging into the secrets of our rituals and the secrets of our principles to find what is behind the actual deeds or works which we're recommended to do. Not only just taking the example of kneeling or prostration or that character or that practice. Our problem is spiritual. On patience, just to see how we lack the understanding of patience and thankfulness. There's a huge connection between them. And I think this is the subject of my lectures in Florida this coming weekend from Al-Imam Al-Ghazali's Ihya Ulumuddin. There's a famous verse in the Quran that reads, وَقَلِيلٌ مِّنْ عِبَادِيَ الشَّكُورِ اِعْمَلُوا آلَ دَاوُودَ شُكْرًا وَقَلِيلٌ مِّنْ عِبَادِيَ الشَّكُورِ. Addressing the family of Prophet David, peace be upon him. Work, present works of thankfulness, yet few of my servants are really thankful. So how come that few are thankful? Well, most people are thankful. If we consider linguistically speaking, thankfulness is expression of words. All Muslims are thankful. If we consider it actions, most Muslims are thankful. But there's a huge difference between Shakir and Shakur in the Arabic language. Shakir is what we call ism fa'il, is simply thankful. Shakur is sighatu mubalagha fa'ul, is very, very thankful. Some scholars reflected upon this and said, thankful, Shakir, is one who thanks Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when he's given. And I tell you, this is natural. But when Allah deprives you, when Allah visits you with calamity, would you maintain the same level of thankfulness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Ash-Shakur is the one who thanks Allah when he is not given, when he thinks he's deprived, when he thinks he is tested with calamities, is thankful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Are you servant of Allah or servant of worldly matters? What's the source of your happiness? If the source of your happiness is money, then when money is gone, you're unhappy. If the source of your happiness is your marital relationship, then when you're separated, you're no longer happy. If the source of your happiness is the society or whatever, politics or whatever, when it is gone, you're not happy. The source of your happiness should be Allah. And then you are always with Allah and you are always happy. Imam Ibn Atallah put it in his invocations. And with this I end. Ilahi, ماذا وجد من فقدك وماذا فقد من وجدك. Oh my Lord, take these words and reflect upon them. No matter how much you lost, and no matter how much you've got, take these words and reflect upon them.
Oh my Lord, he who has lost you, what else has he found? He who has lost you, what else has he found? And he who has found you, what else has he lost? You found Allah, you've lost nothing. Be the happiest on the face of the earth. Allah bless you. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.
Jazakallah khair, Sheikh Muhammad Yaqoubi. See, he's awesome, right? I told you. So, jazakallah khair for your time, for your patience, for your attention. May Allah bless your evening, and may we. I look forward, and you look forward to a wonderful ISNA convention. Jazakumullah khair. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.